Okay, so this lecture we'll talk about more about the standards and like about general topics about how to design an electrical machine. But I want you to understand first the industrial procedures and some standards. Okay, so what do we need to know to design an electric machine? Which parameters should we know if you If someone asks you to design an electrical machine for me, which questions do you ask him?
Torque speed.
Okay,
Power.
torque speed, power, torque ve speed zaten power'ı verir
Voltage.
başka. Voltaj.
Size.
Size limitation, maybe
Efficiency. Application olabilir.
yes. Application'da neye bakacaksın?
İşte duty cycle'ına bakarım. Hani ne kadar süreli mi çalışacak yoksa birazcık overload edebilir
Okay.
miyim ara ara?
Onlar olabilir. Ambient temperature veya işte operating conditions olabilir. İşte mekanik yükte inertia var mı yok mu? İşte kalkış akımları, işte transient performansı önemli mi değil mi? Onlara bakılabilir. Okay, so first you need to decide on the machine type and the type of construction. Rated power and also if there's some limitations on the power factor. That one. Ondan sonra rated speed can be rated frequency. Again, it is for the European market or US market. 50 Hz, 60 Hz, or I don't know if it's going to driven by a inverter. So then, what will be the rated frequency? Duty cycle. We will talk about that one. And closure class, and also other parameters. Because even if you have all those factors, if some guy can give you, okay, I want a 10 kilowatt motor, the same motor, whatever, but then you should ask him, then is the initial cost of the motor is more important, or is the initial cost, you can get an expensive motor, but if the efficiency is really important, or what is the expected life, or is it going to operate just a couple of years, or you want to withstand it like 20 years, 30 years, then you need to have that kind of understanding, because that also affects your topology and also your design decisions. Okay, so the first one you will see a lot in motor catalogs is the duty cycle. So duty cycle, şunu bir açabiliyor muyum? Saniye arkadaşlar. Şimdi daha geldi değil mi şey resim?
geldi.
Okay, so again, you can have like the you will hear some kind of duty cycles. Then you can have S1. S1 is quite the most common one. So it is for continuous running. So that means that motor or generator can be run at like 24 hours all day long without no problem. Or you can have some short time duty. So you can have something like S2 10 to 90 minutes, and I will show you the graphs. And you can have some intermittent periodic duty. So how long is it going to operate and that kind of things. Intermittent periodic duty with starting, so you can have a high inertia or you need some high torque at the starting. So then you can have intermittent periodic duty with electric braking. So in some periods of time, you are working in regenerative braking. So, and again, it can be continuous operating periodic duty, continuous operating periodic duty with electric braking, and it goes on like that. So you have basically eight different categories and like subcategories for that one. So again, I think that will be more useful than those definitions. So basically, S1 is you just turn on the machine and it can run without no problem. So that means when you are designing the machine, the machine can be capable of dissipating all the heat generating even it is run at full load, you know, for continuous operation. So then you have the duty cycle S2. For example, you can run the thing and then it will stop for indefinite of time. I don't know, maybe your hair dryers, you know, that kind of applications or drills. So it can be, you know, again, it can operate for the definitions. You can have like in S2, the operation. So S2, 10, 90 minutes means, so it can operate 10 minutes. So until you can operate it again, you need to wait for another 90 minutes. So the machine will cool down. So then you can start running the machine again. So basically, you know, depending on your time. So your machine doesn't have to be thermally stable. If you run it continuously, maybe it will damage itself. But due to heat capacity of the motor, it can withstand, you know, that kind of short amount of operations. Then there's the intermittent operation. So it can start, stop, then it can start, stop again, you know, that kind of operations. So for S4, that means you have some kind of either high starting torque requirement or maybe you have high inertia. So that means you will draw the starting currents for considerable amount of time. Then you will operate, then you will stop. You will start like that, for example, elevators, you know, that kind of thing. So they will consume more power when it is reaching to the rated speed, then it will stop, then it will start again. So then you can have the regenerative braking at the end of the cycle. There's another duty cycles, and again, you know, what was S7? S7 is continuous operating periodic duty with electric braking, and again, those are, you know, continuous. It just apart from that one, you don't have any periods, any off periods, but in S7, it is all continuous. For example, if you have an electric car, then the electric car motor should be capable of doing that kind of stuff. If you are stuck in a traffic, then you are regenerating, accelerating, going, and it can run for hours. Okay, so again, you can run at different loads, and it just goes on and on. Again, there are like different subcategories. But when you open a motor catalog, usually they define, you know, what is the operating duty cycle for that motor. Okay. Then the probably the, you know, the most important standard in electrical machines is IEC, you know, 634. So this is the standard for rotating electric machinery. You can have the summary here. And in that standard, so basically IEC standard, then there's a chapter 30. So it defines the efficiency standards, and this is now the most important parameter, especially for commercial products. For example, you can have IE1, which is called the standard efficiency. So I will show you the figures. Then you can have IE2, which is called high efficiency. Then you can have IE3, premium efficiency. Then the last one, you know, they just introduced that one. So it is the IE4, and it is the super premium efficiency. Okay. So all the efficiencies are going like that. So let me show you the figures. So again, IE1, this is not as a factor of the operating load, but this is the rated power. Okay, so for smaller motors, again, for smaller motors, it is more difficult to have a high efficiency motor, but as the size increases, the efficiency can increase. So basically, IE1 is less restrictive for smaller motors. So for example, if you have a 3 kilowatt motor at full load, so if the efficiency is 83%, 85%, so that means you are at IE1 efficiency, then that is IE2 efficiency, then that is IE3 efficiency. So you can see as the basically Motor rated power goes to 100 kilowatt. So basically you want to get as high as 96-97% efficiency for IE4 motors. So basically European Union puts lots of limitations, and actually it is quite a problem for some manufacturers in Turkey, because in order to export it to European Union countries, you have to show that your machines are within those standards. And actually 5 years ago at 2015, so they said all the motors between 7.5 to 375, so basically from here to here, all the motors should be at least IEC3 efficiency. So all the motors sold in European Union has to be here. I mean, basically the reason is quite sensible, because we are trying to reduce the global warming and carbon emissions, that kind of things, and almost like half of the energy that we generated, so we are burning natural gas, nuclear power plants, whatever, and half of that power is being used in electric motors. So basically if you can improve the efficiency of electric motors, so that make a big difference in terms of carbon emissions and stuff. So anyway, so for the last 5 years we had that one, so it just applies to motors larger than 7.5 kilowatt. And next year they will put another barrier, so they will put, I think that should be IEC3, sorry. So at first it was for motors larger than 7.5 kilowatts. Now it will cover motors between 0.75 kilowatt to 7.5 kilowatts. So basically for that category, all IE2 motors should be at least IE3 now. So actually some manufacturers in Turkey are trying to modify their designs to meet that limitation. So again, in 3 years' time, so they say all large motors, 75 to 200 kilowatt motors, must meet IE4. So basically for here, so actually those are large motors consuming lots of power in industrial applications. So you are actually pushing the efficiency even higher. And another limitation is coming, I didn't write to here. And again, all the applications should be driven by variable frequency drives, because if you are just not for the constant speed applications, but for example, if you are using a variable speed application, for example, if you have pump and if you are adjusting the speed or the flow of water by some kind of mechanical solutions, then they are not really efficient. So they require all that motors should be coupled with inverters. So again, it means quite challenging for industry, but at the same time, the companies are looking all the solutions to improve their efficiencies. Okay.
Hocam,
Var mı?
megawattlık makinelerde da geçerli mi bunlar?
Geçerli abi senin motor mesela. Yani şeyde ona girmiyor. Yani onu soruyorsan, hani rüzgar türbinlerinde aslında bu geçerli değil, veya jeneratörlerde hani şey olarak geçerli değil. Çünkü zaten sen orada elektrik ürettiğin için hani onlarda öyle bir spesifikasyon olmuyor. Ama işte motor olarak çalışan endüstriyel uygulamalarda kullanılan şeylerde geçerli oluyor. Ama diğer tarafta düşünürsen de hani şey olmasa da hani rüzgar türbininde işte senle de işte o konuyu konuşuyoruz, yani verimi düşürmek demek. Tamam, belki adama maliyet azaltıyorsun ama işte %5 daha fazla elektrik üretip satıp para kazanabilecekken sen onu ısıya dönüştürüyorsun. Aslında hani öyle bir yaptırımı var. Yani orada da bir endüstride verimi yukarıya çıkarmaya çalışıyorlar. Okay. Then we have another standard, so it is for degrees of protection. So it can be both to the user, like you can't put your fingers inside of the rotor, or it can mean to protect the motor itself from the outside elements. So basically you will see actually they use the same logic for the mobile phones and electronics. So IP67 iPhones or that kind of things, you hear that kind of notations. So this is the ingress or water protection. So basically the first letter here, so the first letter IP5 here, so if that one is 2, so that means motors are protected against solid objects greater than 12 millimeter. Okay, so basically you can't put your finger into the motor, but anything smaller than 12 millimeter can get into the motor. Again, you know, those are not really preferred nowadays, but just to know. So then you have the 4, so motors protected against solid objects greater than 1 millimeter. So again, if you have IP40 something protection, that means again the dust or small particles larger than 1 millimeter cannot get into the motor, but you can have some dust or really fine particles inside of the motor. And then you have the 5, so they are dust protected motors, so there will be no dust or small materials getting into the motor. And the I mean, it can get into the dust can get into the motor, but it will not give any damage to the motor. The other one is dust tight, so basically, you know, not any particle will get into the motor. So basically, if you just think of a motor, the main entrance point is the bearings or the cooling fans, cooling ducts, that kind of things. So you take enough precaution to limit that thing. Okay. So then the second letter, second number here is, for example, 6. For that one is just defines the water protection or water ingress protection. So if this motor was a IP53, so that means motors protected against spraying water. So if there is a rain, that will be fine. But apart from that one, if you just wash it with some pressure washer, you will damage the motor. So then you can have 4 motors protected against splashing water. You can have a bucket of water and just throw it, then nothing will happen. Then you will have motors protected against water jets. Again, you know, high pressure washing, or I don't know, in the sea applications, whenever there is some water is coming with high pressure. And then there's the 6. So this is especially for offshore applications. So even if, you know, you can just have any kind of motor, any kind of water, and it will not damage the motor. And the 7, actually I didn't write, why is it getting I? Okay, I forgot to introduce it here. So there's also 7. 7 is motors are protected against submersion. I think there's also some standards like 1 meter submersion and that kind of things. So the highest protection that you can get is IP67. So IP67 is dust free and they are protected against submersion and that kind of things. Again, you know, some new electronics, mobile phones have IP67 protection. Okay. Yusuf, senin sesini duymuyoruz. Sorun varsa yani açabilirsin ya da yazabilirsin.
Tamam hocam. Sorun.
Geldi soru. Geldi sesin.
Tamam. Hocam demek ki Botox bildiğimiz
Botox. Hocam Yusuf değil, diğer Yusuf galiba.
Ha, Yusuf Kösek Soy yazdı. Konuşan bizim Yusuf muydu? Ben ses alamadım. Basri miydi?
Evet.
Okay. Evet. O zaman Yusuf Köse Soy soracaksa yazabilir. Sen water jet dedin. Şey, yani su jeti, su kesme jeti değil abi. Onu soruyorsan. Gökhan, yani su jeti dedi işte high pressure washer'lar var ya bu oto yıkamacılarda filan. O evet. Tarz bir water jet, yoksa su jetinin altına koysan kesersin abi motor. Kestiniz yani. Tekst yani şeyler kopmuş herhalde de. Özgür, sen nasıl çözmüştün?
Ya ben bir şey yapamadım aslında.
Bir şey yapmadım, çözüldü diyorsun. Gelmiş. Neyse, okey. Kayıttan dinlersin, kötü değil mi? Okay, so then we have the vaulted standards. And again, for delta connections, you know, you can have 220, 210, 40. And again, if it is for US or Japan, it can be 110 and that kind of stuff. And it is Y connected, you can have the line to line voltages. And there, I mean, it is becoming less and less common, but there are also some 500 volts delta connected motors. The other common one is 660 to 690 volts. So it is the square root 3 of 400 volts. So they are called the Y-connected motors. Then apart from that, so any voltage higher than the 1 kilovolts is called the medium voltage motors. So you can have like 3.3 kilovolt motors for large applications. And also there is some 6.6 kilovolt motor applications. But, you know, if you have any options, you want to limit your voltage to those levels, because if you are going over 1000 voltage, then the installation and also the connection, the power converter will be more expensive. And also the, you know, technicians working with that machines have to have some kind of medium voltage certification. So the manufacturers actually, if the size allows, they just prefer to have that kind of voltages. Okay. Then I think the second most important one, apart from the efficiency, is the frame sizes. So basically, once you open a motor catalog, you will see that kind of parameters. One of them is like the size of the shaft. The other one is the length of the shaft and the length of the motor between those bolts and the width of those bolts, whatever. But that H parameter, okay, that H parameter is the most important term when defining a motor. Türkçe'de de işte gövde boyu falan diyorlar. So basically, if you tekrar bir ekran paylaşayım. So basically, once you open a motor, let me open that one first. So this is a motor catalog from, I think, Siemens. So again, so you can see standard motors up to frame size 315 le, I think L is for long, whatever. So that means, ya da Türkçe'de işte gövde, kaç gövde istiyorsun abi, işte 80 gövden var, 120 gövden var filan diye konuştuklarında. So that frame size basically defines that H. So it is the distance from the that leg point to the center of the shaft in millimeters. Okay, so in for IEC standard it is in millimeters, but for NEMA standard they are in inches. But anyway, so if that motor catalog says 315L, so that means the attachment point, you know, the base point to the medium, middle of that shaft is 315 millimeters, so it is 30 centimeters, so it is quite a high motor. Okay, again, let me open that catalog again. For industrial applications, you know, those sizes are quite standard. So for example, here they are called in D. So D here is the body length, body size. So basically you have 56, you have 63, 71, 80. Again, you know, I don't know why they are going like strange numbers, but probably in the inch imperial system. So you have 100, so 10 centimeter, 112, so it goes up to like that. I think now it is limited, but then you have 374, that kind of limit. So because I think it is that standard is just to make all the motors compatible with each other. So if you have a mechanical load, so at least you can find a motor from a different manufacturer, then if they have the same size, you can just attach it directly without any complex interfaces. Okay. Var mı sorusu olan? Okay, so let's talk about the design procedure. So first, you know, when you are starting with a motor, we will do some more exercise in the following weeks. So basically, first you need to decide about the motor type and construction. Are you going to use a induction motor? Is it going to be more suitable for a permanent magnet motor? You know, that kind of applications. And what will be the power rating? Again, it will be a, will it be a 1 kilowatt motor, 1 megawatt motor? And again, even just having the power rating itself is not enough. So what you need is the rated power as well, because you can have a really high speed motor, let's say 100,000 RPM. So you can have, you know, that kind of machine with at 1 megawatt, with liquid cooled and that kind of stuff. Or you can have a direct drive wind turbine generator, which is rotating around 15-20 RPM, so it will be like several meters in diameter. So then again, the rated frequency, what will be the interface look like? Rated voltage, will it be going to be directly grid connected, or are you going to drive it with a frequency drive, that kind of things. And again, intended usage, duty cycles, and enclosure class. So is it going to be operating under, you know, challenging environments? Is it going to be inside of a laboratory? That kind of stuff. Okay. So then again, we will do those exercises next week, so don't worry for now. But first you need to decide on the magnetic loading and electric loading. So basically, magnetic loading is proportional to flux density in the air gap. And electric loading, I mean, for those who has taken the 564 course, probably you know those definitions. So electric loading is proportional with how much current, not the actual current, but proportional to current density. So magnetic loading is limited by the saturation, you know, permanent magnets you used or the materials that you used. And electric loading is mainly limited by the thermal. So if it is an air-cooled machine, then the air, electric loading will be less. If it is a liquid-cooled machine, you can improve the electric loading. So you need to decide on that kind of factors. Then, you know, first you need to decide what should be the approximate size of the machine. So you need to choose the diameter and the axial length. And based on those parameters, at least you have a starting point. They don't have to be your final decisions. You can make many iterations, but just to start, I think those are good parameters. Then, depending on your application, rotating speed, machine type, then you need to define an air gap clearance. Is it going to be 1 millimeter, 2 millimeter, 0.1 millimeter? So then you can start working on how many number of slots I will have, what will be the winding type, what should be the number of coils to couple that machine with the rated voltage values, blah, blah. Okay, then once you have a rough estimation, then you will work the details in your electrical machines. So how many slots are you going to use? How many tooths are they going to be in the state range rotor? Then you can make a rough estimation of the machine performance. Then basically you will just go to the step one. If the results are not satisfactory, you modify some parameters, run it again, change it again, you know, analyze it again. So basically, either you can do it yourself, like a parametric sweep, you can see how does the parameter affect, or basically the most common method is you can use some kind of optimization algorithms and let the optimization algorithm to choose the best design depending on your cost function. Okay? Any questions? Sohbetinize de doyum olmuyor.
Hocam, magnetic loading derken AirGap'teki Platinus'tan bahsetmiştik değil mi? Yani tam olarak AirGap'in neresi oluyor? Yani tam ortasındaki...
Yani onu işte haftaya falan daha matematiksel olarak anlatacağım. Aslında şey oluyor yani average magnetic loading. Hani şey yap böyle bizim bir hani sinusoidal bir distribution'umuz olsun. Onun sonra işte flux purple için average'ini buluyorduk. Yani 2 bölü pi ile falan çarpıyorduk. Aslında işte şey demek yani hani benim flux linkage'im buysa, flux alanım buysa demek ki average magnetic load'um ne olmalı? Yani magnetic loading'in birim işte Tesla, Weber per meter square. Hani oradan onu buluyorsun. Okay? Yani ona göre de işte şeyleri hani mıknatısın ne kadar olun. Yani illa her zaman magnetic loading'i seçip oradan yola başlıyoruz gibi de olmak zorunda değil. Yani mıknatısı seçip sonra magnetic loading'im ne olmuş diye de bakabilirsin. Ama genel olarak işte hani makinalarda şeyler hani elektrik loading daha değişken olabilir. Hani işte soğutmaya göre, şuna göre, buna göre ama genelde şey magnetic loading işte saturasyonla biraz daha limitli. Hani eyvallah kaliteli malzeme kullanarak yukarıya çıkarabilirsin ama hani tutup 3 Tesla'da yaptığım şey makine olmadığı için oralarda biraz daha elin kolun bağlı. Okay. So then I think after you start those things, then you know first the diameter is the air gap diameter, then what should be the outer diameter? So outer diameter is also depending your slot length, back core thickness. We will talk about those parameters, don't worry. Air gap clearance, so stator stack length, what should be the length of my motor? Should I choose a large diameter and a short axial length, or should I choose a long axial length and a short diameter? Again, it can depend on your application. So what is the best combination of number of stator and rotor slots, or in our case what is the stator slots and what is the number of magnets, what is the number of poles in the machine, and again the dimensions of the slot and teeth and the winding diagram. Is it going to be a, you know, concentrated winding, integral slot winding, fractional slot winding? So you need to decide on those parameters. Okay, so where to start and where is the torque generator? So basically, if you just look closely, and there's a definition called, actually we talk about those things in the early weeks, so it is called the Maxwell stress tensor. So it can be written as 1 over 2 mu 0 h square, or basically it is b square over 2 mu 0. So that unit is what? What is the unit of that equation? Yes, that is also called magnetic pressure. So that unit is Pascal. So basically you can have two magnets. So the Maxwell stress tensor is how many, you know, newtons per meter square are trying to attach those magnets. So basically you can calculate the flux density, you can have the pressure, then you can multiply that thing with the surface area, and then you can find the total force. And actually if you just plot the flux density vectors in a machine, okay, so we have an example here. So which direction will it rotate? So for example, will it şey başlatayım gene. Clockwise or counterclockwise? Okay, so basically most of you did it correct. It will rotate at the counterclockwise direction. So why? Because basically you can think those flux lines, okay, you can think those flux lines as some strings. We talk about that thing in the early weeks, some strings pulling it in that direction. So the pressure here is from here to here. So you can think that one like small strings pulling the rotor, so it will rotate from right to the left. So in other words, it will rotate in counterclockwise direction like that. Okay. So then there are also some definitions about, I mean, that's value, by the way. Let me go back. Okay, so that value is the total flux. So basically, for example, again, let's say this is your rotor and this is your magnet. So I am moving that magnet and it will try to rotate aligned position. So I am moving here, so it will rotate. So basically, if they are aligned perfectly like that, so that means you still have the attraction force, so there's some still B, but that flux direction is directly in the radial direction. So in radial direction, it will try to pull it out of the rotor position, but it will not cause any rotation. So basically, the magnitude of Maxwell's stress tensor is the total attraction force, but it doesn't mean it will all in the rotating direction. The rotation direction is not the radial component, but the tangential component. So basically, if I move that magnet, so the flux lines, or as in the previous example, so basically you have those flux lines. So the main part of that thing is in the tangential direction. So it's trying to rotate it, but there is some force in the radial direction. So in the radial direction, it will try to open the rotor. Again, it is limited by the bearing, so it can't move. So instead, it will rotate. So once we say the shear stress, I'm talking about the tangential force on that machine, or tangential magnetic pressure in the machine surface. And again, you know, these are just some rule of thumbs. You can go above or beyond those values. For industrial motors, for small industrial motors, the usual average shear stress value is 0.7 to 2 kilopascal. So that means if you have a cylindrical surface like that, okay, so basically you can calculate that value, and you can multiply it with the surface area of the cylinder, and then you can get an overall force. Then using the diameter, you can calculate the torque approximately that you can generate from that machine without even doing anything with the permanent magnets, windings, that kind of thing. So basically, these are just starting points just to decide, like, are you going to use a 10 centimeter diameter rotor, 30 centimeter diameter rotor, or a 1 meter diameter motor. So these are, you know, useful in that manner. And again, for large industrial motors, and again with some extra cooling and that kind of things, you can go up to 40, 12, 15 Pascal. And industrial servo motors, permanent magnet motors, are usually in this range. Okay, so again, if you just improve the cooling with some liquids, water cooled machines, they can go up to 100 kilopascals. Okay, so then magnetic loading again. Next week I will solve some numeric examples, but it is for Yusuf's question. So it is the average air gap flux density over a pole. So basically, you can have flux per pole, then you have the number of poles, so it is total flux going out of the rotor surface, and basically PDIL. What is that parameter? What is that parameter?
Rotor area.
Evet, rotor surface area. So if you have a cylinder like that, so again, it is that area. P times D is the circumference, and length is here. So basically it is all the rotor surface. So in other words, it is, if you just move that P down to here, so it is the pole area. So it is flux per pole divided by pole area, or total flux divided by total surface area. Okay.
Hocam bir şey söyleyeyim mi?
Tabii.
Pole area üzerinde niye bakıyoruz? Yani pole sayısı burada neden önemli? Direkt toplam flux bölü rotorun areası yapsak
olmaz. Yok, zaten öyle yapıyorsun işte. Ama şu, yani şu toplam flux değil de şu flux per pole, onu pole sayısıyla çarptığın zaman toplam flux'ı buluyorsun.
Yani toplam flux'tan gidiyoruz.
Evet, yani şu toplam flux'ı veriyor, ya da işte flux per pole'dan diye düşünüyorsan bunu burada bölülü diye düşünebilirsin, bölü P. O da flux per pole'un pole area'ya bölünmüş hali. Bunu bununla çarpınca toplam flux'ın toplam alana bölünmüş hali de olabiliyor. Okay. Again, here you see some kind of numbers for different values. And actually, there is not much variation like as in torque or as in electric loading. So what we are looking when we say electric loading is calculated at the air gap. So we are looking at here. So induction motors have a peak value of the fundamental. So this is not the magnetic loading, but this is rather the peak value. So it is 0.7 to 0.9. I mean, for salient pole synchronous machines, it can go 0.85 to 1.05, and usually it is in that range. The maximum value is around 1 Tesla. Why it is like that? Why it is not like 1.6 Tesla, if I know the flux density can go up 1.6 Tesla without saturating.
Furkan mı söylüyor?
Yok, bilmem. Söyledi bir şey de anlamadım Furkan.
Sen air gap'ten ötürü dedi
mi? Air gap'ten ötürü derken?
Yani air gap olunca işte orada şeyde gördüğümüz flux density azalıyor diye düşünmüştüm. Normal bir trafoda işte gapsiz olunca biraz daha fazla şeyler bulabiliriz.
Yok ama diyelim şeyin var, hani mıknatıslı da düşünme, şeyin var. Winding coil'in var. İstediğin kadar akım basabiliyorsun yani. Şeyi air gap'te hani 1.5 Tesla yaratabiliyorsun. Gene de yaratmak mantıklı olur mu, olmaz mı?
O zaman materyal satırı olmaz mı yani?
İşte tam 1.5 Tesla'ya kadar gidebiliyor malzeme. Air gap flux density niye 1.5 Tesla yapmıyorum?
Diş alanı air gap olmadan işte konsantre oluyor. O yüzden
evet. Evet, Özgür'ün dediği aslında. Yani şuraya çizmeye çalışayım. Şimdi işte şurası şeyiniz olsun, rotorunuz olsun. İşte şurada şeyimiz var, statorumuz var. Ama statorun işte yarısında tuğut var. Yani bu dedinenler bu arada şeyler için, hani normal klasik slotlu makinalar için. Şurası backcore. Şimdi atıyorum. Ben şunu da kırmızı yapayım. Şimdi şuradan hop. Şey yapamadım ya. Gelsem. Hiçbir şekilde Zoom'da takılı kaldı. Ama dur bakayım. Pardon arkadaşlar. Şunu şöyle alsam. Şurada geri alsam. Okay. So basically, if you have a sinusoidal distribution, I don't know, peak flux density here, okay? If you have a flux density here, and if that flux density is, let's say, 1.5 Tesla, so the problem is depending on your number of things. So over that range, you are generating 1.5 Tesla, but all that flux has to concentrate on that area. So basically depending on the tooth pitch and the slot pitch. Now let's say these are equal to each other. So basically you have twice the area and it is concentrated on one side. So basically the peak air gap flux density, which you have 1.5 Tesla, can be only transferred if you can have 3 Tesla at that point. So because of that, you don't want to go beyond saturation through here. Let's say this is 1.6 Tesla. So that implies you should give 0.8 Tesla here. So which is, you know, really, you know, consistent with the values here. But of course, if you have, let's say, you know, this is for slotted machines, and that is another advantage. If you have some kind of air cord machine right here, air cord machine, so that means, let's say you have your coils here, whatever. So in that case, I mean, you can have 1.5 Tesla here because they are not concentrated in the slots like in the previous case. So you can have all 1.5 Tesla over the coils. But now we have a problem because in the previous case, basically the gap distance is that red area, green area. Okay, so here we have the magnetic gap like that. So yes, technically you can generate 1.5 Tesla. It doesn't saturate the teeth, but now it is much more difficult to generate 1.5 Tesla because you now have a high reluctance. So that means you need to apply a larger MMF signal, MMF waveform. Okay. Cool. So these are for, again, typical values. It doesn't mean you can't go over that one, but just as a starting point. So then we have the electric loading. We will talk about how to calculate those things. So don't worry for now. But it is the RMS ampere turns per unit length of the air gap. So what does it mean? So you are basically have N slots. Okay, so you have Q slots. Each slot is carrying I. So you have, let's say, 60 slots. And at every slot, you have one coil with 1 ampere. And every slot, let's say you have 10 turns. So 10 turns per slot and 1 ampere at each coil with 60 slot. That means you have 600 amps across the circumference of the rotor, and we are counting all the phases. Then you are dividing it to the circumference of the air gap diameter. So that is just a factor. It doesn't have a directly meaning, but it is just a factor how, you know, thermally is your motor is loaded. So basically, if you have a more current, you will have a high electric loading. Okay. Again, the unit is kiloamps per meter, so it is the same as like H, but it doesn't really matter directly H. But this one, for example, again for induction motors, you know, 30 to 65 amps per kiloamps per meter is seems standard. And again, you can calculate the current density. It is 3 to 8 amps per millimeter square. And for PMSMs, they can go, you know, slightly higher. For air-cooled motors, it is that value. If you have direct water cooling or hydrogen cooling for very large machines, you can basically double or triple that number. And instead of using a 3 to 8 amps per millimeter square, you can go up to 7 to 10. And there are even some higher applications with direct water cooling, direct water jackets, you can have current densities up to 13, 18 amps per millimeter square. So just as a start, you know, 5, 6 amps per millimeter square is a nice approximation for current density. If you find some current densities in the order of 100 amps per millimeter square, that means your design is not feasible from the start. Okay. So again, you know, these are again some other machines, and again by using the electric loading and by using the area flux density values or magnetic loading, you can calculate the tangential stress. So again, this is in terms of the pascals, and you can multiply that number with the rotor surface area to calculate the total force or total torque. So, you know, just again, for a starting number for your design, you know, those rule of thumbs can be useful. Okay. Let's finish here. So we will talk about those mathematical representations next week. So if you don't have any questions, let's stop here, and I will continue next week. Okay.